Umaji, I promise that you know your hope of having a very different presentation will surely be realized. It surely is very different than what we just saw. It was a very great learning experience. Talking about India, I have assumed a lot of things that audience will not know. And I just straightaway want to look at a big picture of what the governance in India. I was invited for this keynote address only 2 days back. I apologize if I am not really prepared. That is the first time I am giving such a keynote address. But I am also thankful for the organizers to be merciful, because they said I can talk about problems and prospects, which can actually mean anything under the sky. So thank you very much for giving me that liberty. India's water sector is under turbulence. There is the phrase World Bank report about 6-7 years ago entitled. There is a broad consensus that India's water sector is facing serious challenges in almost everything. The water establishment to accept this fact generally. Most analysts talk about specific things and how to deal with them. But there is a very less significant body of analysis, at least I haven't seen too much of it, about the state of water governance in India and our unique challenges and opportunities in that context. So some of the key challenges I'll just go through first. The groups like ours, I come from an organization called South Asia Network on Dams, Rivers and People, but I have been also part of the Narmada movement. So groups like ours have been infamous for coming out with long chart sheets concerning India's water sector. Here are some things that we see that is a broad consensus. Groundwater governance, there are millions of users, depleting levels, deteriorating quality. There is the challenge of access to reliable and affordable electricity. In terms of large surface irrigation projects, at the last annual partners meeting from this dais at plenary, Tushar declared an obituary of India's large surface water projects. I called it then an exaggerated obituary, but I believe it still is an exaggerated obituary. Even today, the maximum amount of investment of India's water sector goes for large irrigation projects. It remains a mainstream in terms of expenditure. But at that, in terms of at least for 2 decades, in any fresh area under irrigation. There are key environmental management challenges in terms of dealing with rivers, forests, biodiversity, floodplains, watersheds. And there is, I was very glad to see that Chinese presentation talked about ecosystem ramifications. I hope it's still that it's really there. There isn't much in India in looking at the ecosystem level ramifications of what we do at a specific project. Water pollution, the problems are increasing, but frankly there is no solution in sight. I don't see any success story in dealing with water pollution in India. I've been asking, please show us one where the establishment has achieved some success. We generally do not seem to have a clue what to do. Floods and droughts. The frequencies and extent are increasing, manual damages are going up. There are very serious issues of equity and distribution. Corruption is a big issue. It's only now it's breaking out in Maharashtra in terms of the contractor, engineer, bureaucrat, politician nexus. But it's only Maharashtra happens to be the state which has built the largest number of big dams in India. And so possibly it's natural that it's coming out there first. But my suspicion is that in years to come we will see more of these stories. On water supply and sanitation, and I believe corruption is one of the biggest governance issues. On water supply and sanitation, in urban areas there are increasing demands, increasingly from longer distances, sewage treatment gap between the required treatment and actual what's happening in terms of destruction of urban water bodies, and very little happening terms of groundwater recharge or rainwater harvesting. In rural area, there are serious issues of quality, equity, basic access, both for needs and livelihoods. In terms of food production, there are serious issues in terms of cropping patterns, equity, distribution. The list can be longer. This itself is a long list. There could be different issues concerning each of these challenges, but I think they are all related. You might say that we rarely define what is, we talk about governance rarely defined. I actually looked for definition before coming here. What I found was that governance is essentially what government does. It's supposed to relate it to decisions that define expectations, grant power, verify performance. And it's expected to reflect the governance system in a country. In India, being a democracy, it's supposed to reflect democratic values. That's our expectation. The elements of water governance include constitutional provisions, there is a legal framework, and there is a lot of, unnecessary debate about whether water should be state sector, I mean state subject or a central subject or a conference subject. There is of course historical pre- and post-colonial context. There is the institutional mechanism, how the institutions work, what is the history, the capacity to learn, innovate, develop, benefit and the sector. There is the issue of planning and decision making, and there are democratic elements, and there should be democratic elements in each of them. Basically in terms of transparent functioning, accountability mechanisms, and this is the participation of the people on ground. How, and then of course the larger pillars of democracy as they are called, they deal with this issue. In terms of historical context, there is of course the pre-colonial and colonial situation. I am not going into all these things, flagging all these are very important in the context of the way the governance has evolved and where we can look at it today. Post-independence area, era there is, there was actually post-independence time was a big opportunity to break from the past. The first big opportunity that India had. How far have we succeeded is a question. I don't see we have really succeeded in using that opportunity. The second big era that came about is the post-LPG era, the liberalization era. There we don't see really any change in the governance, but there are changing demand patterns and increasingly unresponsive supply projects. And this is also very coincidental that it started the same time, both the phenomenon. And then there is the climate change era, which is again an opportunity again to break from the past and learn mistakes from the past and then go forward in a new way. Seems like it's also a wasted opportunity if you look at the way India's National Action Plan on Climate Change was formulated, the process and the content, and also National Water Mission, which is a part of that National Action Plan on Climate Change. Of course, this is the International Institute's platform. So let us look at what India can learn in terms of water governance from other countries. We can learn a lot from USA in terms of environmental governance. In terms of institutes like USGS, it's a unique institute in US where it gathers the data, unlike in Central Water Commission in India, which does so many things together. In India, in US, USGS does all the data gathering, and all of the data is immediately in public domain. There's no secrecy anymore. Which is a kind of institute that we can possibly learn from and think about. There is the groundwater banking accounting, which is very, I was surprised to see last year when I was invited there to see, look at the water sector there. There is the Clean Water Act, this is the 40th anniversary year of that. Ecological river management, free flowing rivers, decommissioning of dams. From China, we can learn, I was surprised to see that China has less irrigated area, but almost three times more food grain production. The yields are so much higher. And how do we cope with the size of population and growth of economy? From Europe, one can learn successful transboundary river management, water framework directive, which is means environment, water and other sectors, Netherlands, Nepal, Bangladesh. We can learn a lot of things from different areas, and then there are other aspects of international context, NCMT rules, UNPT. I think it's likely to be ratified, and it's likely to be effective soon, the 35 required countries ratifying it. The WCD report, Jeremy mentioned in the morning, and he was part of it, and we have had fortune of working together. We from outside, he was within the secretariat. But we believe that's another opportunity that India has missed, actually, in terms of India participated, the government participated fully in the process of the WCD, but when the report came, we didn't find it comfortable or convenient and rejected it. Rejected is inverted commas because there was no process, actually. One arm of the government rejected, other arms have been still talking about implementation. There are other contexts, listen. In last year, there was a very interesting conference where, again, I think Jeremy was there in Germany, where they talked about the water, food and energy security nexus. I think it's a very useful concept, and we need to really dwell into it, how we can build this into our government system. The only trouble with that was that I think they forgot the fourth leg of that nexus, the environment, which has to be thought together with those three. But I think more than outside, possibly we need to look within, in the context of water, society, environment. India is unique, diverse, complex, and there is very little similarity with respect to any other country in the world. We have been meandering along, managing somehow. These are again the words of the World Bank report that Grisco and company authored. Somewhat like our Jugaad style, typical Indian Jugaad style. We have been going along, we have been managing somehow. But it's doubtful how long we can continue. The intensity and complexity of the challenges is increasing manifold. The climate change will make it worse. Very surprisingly, this year, in November itself, thermal power projects and breweries are getting closed down for lack of water in Maharashtra, just post-monsoon. It's happening in other places also. The issues of multiple agencies will remain. You know, one of the typical things that keep coming up discussion is that we have so many agencies working and how can we work. You know? It's likely to remain. Every sector that deals with water has to deal with it. The trouble is not there so many sectors, agencies dealing with. The problem is the thinking in terms of exclusive and non-interacting silos, lack of coordination between agencies in a transparent, participatory way, in an institutionalized way. And wherever even there has been an attempt to build those coordinating mechanisms, it has not really succeeded. We seem to have too much faith in technology, in infrastructure, in funds, in funding agencies, but we seem to lack faith in people and democracy. Reforms from establishment in last few years, these are some of the reforms that the established water resource establishment has thrown up over the last few years. From the Ministry of Water Resources, Central Water Commission, there was some talk about river basin management. It has really never taken off. Command area development, serious issues about implementation. Even the most celebrated project of India, Sardar Sarovar project, doesn't have even the command area development plan, even now, for all this full command area, leave aside implementation. Participatory irrigation management, water users association. Grisco, when he was at the helm of World Bank water sector in Delhi, he talked about big bang change in Andhra Pradesh. We have seen what has happened to that big bang. We don't see any sign of that change. Accelerated irrigation benefit program, national projects on irrigation, interlinking of rivers, settlement of National Water Development Agency. These are some of the things that has come out of water sector. From rural development, Ministry of Environment, Ministry of Agriculture, watershed development has been a major reform that has happened in the last few decades. From the Ministry of Environment and Forest, environment management, since mid-80s this has started, and
I believe this has been a bigger driver of change than anything else in the way the water sector is dealt with in India. But it has a lot more potential to do. 40 years ago, we set up a pollution control mechanism, a national river conservation plan, starting with Ganga Action Plan in mid-80s again, Water Quality Assessment Authority. This was supposed to be a coordination between Ministry of Environment and Water Resources. Never really took off. And then there is a regulatory authority, which is basically pushed by the World Bank in Maharashtra. But we have yet to see any, it's been in existence for 7 years now. And Maharashtra seems to be at the epitome of everything wrong with India's water sector, at least what comes coming out in the news today. The other thing that is happening with a number of things, under this groundwater management issue, which is again part of the World Bank project, but this is something we can learn from, and I'm looking forward to what Tushar said, there will be new research coming from this program. Himachal Pradesh was the first state in India which talked about environment flows and fisheries. They reserved rivers which should not be developed and they should reserve for fisheries. In terms of power sector, which is related to water, the segregation of rural and agricultural grids, which started in Gujarat, is now catching up in other states, which Tushar has been talking so much about, which is really the important reform that has come out from the government. From the judiciary, under the judiciary dictate, the Central Groundwater Authority was set up in mid-1990s. Nothing has effective implementation, nothing effective impact we can see so far. Some non-starter reforms, 73rd, 74th constitutional amendments, giving water among the 29 subjects to the local panchayats. It's really the non-starter. Similarly, panchayat extension in scheduled areas and FRA. The Planning Commission is starting with new 12th five-year plan with a lot of reform agenda. I am not sure how far it will go, but let us hope it will go. The question is there credible evidence of effectiveness of any of these reform measures? There are other non-solutions that has come out from the government, tribunals, state water, interstate water problem. Actually, the water problems are going from interstate to even intrastate. This year in Maharashtra, both in Godavari and Krishna Basin, upstream dams have stopped up water and downstream dams are empty. And they are talking about why only interstate, why should the Maharashtra upstream dams should not release water regularly for the downstream areas. So the problems are going far. Big dams are not really delivering. Interlinking of rivers with promise to solve drought and flood problems. Big hydro, 50,000 megawatt initiative that started in Vajpayee era. Particularly Northeast and Himalayas, CDM Hydro under the UNFCCC, water prioritization and market-based reforms, that I think I need to go fast. The World Bank, ADP, DFID and other sectors have been, other agencies have been involved for very, very long in India, in every conceivable water sector. I would like to see that what has really been the lasting contribution of their business. This is the graph which I have wondered always showing. This shows that how much NR irrigation area has been going on at the net irrigated area from medium and major irrigation projects at all India level over the last 22 decades. And it's actually been going down if you look at the trend line. This is all official data, Ministry of Agriculture. So some of the fundamental reforms that are yet to come, most basic water data is top secret even today in India. Basic documents related to public purpose projects, secret. There are no reliable statistics about basic aspects like irrigated area, water allocation for specific areas, specific purpose. No credible performance appraisal, no role for concerned people and communities in planning, decision making, monitoring or operations. No clearly defined mechanism for water allocation or accountability. Current consumption and growth pattern are not sustainable, but there is no acknowledgement of this. I see Central Water Commission hydrocracy should be hydrocracy also, you can look at it if you want to. It's a sort of microcosm of India's water resource establishment. Actually, it should have been D, somebody has put it. E should have been E instead of B, I thought you are E. Doesn't matter. Historical antecedents, it has, it's a legacy of colonial times. It is a massive bureaucracy. I looked at the website today, 3,500 and odd people work in Central Water Commission. It's supposed to be top technical body, but it is also deeply involved in data gathering, data management, monitoring, decision making, regulation, research, development, lobbying. It's actually lobbying for big banks. Dispute resolution, project preparation, bank safety, climate change, consultancy, international issues, you name it, they do it. Now the trouble is that there are a lot of conflict of interest between these different roles. And so we need to look at this institute very closely. It's the fulcrum of India's water establishment actually. But there has been really not too much analysis of how it functions. It's one of the most non-transparent. It hates accountability. It does not recognize need for participatory processes at all. It doesn't like independent oversight, learning lessons or performance evaluation. Never put it at a pedestal actually. And unfortunately, it didn't put any checks and balances. By 1958, they realized that mistake. He gave a speech before the CDIP in 1958 November. And he talked about the disease of gigantism that this institute seems to be suffering from. But by that time, either he didn't have time or inclination or will to correct the situation, he didn't do anything. I'm sorry this may like very uncharitable, but it's, you know, Central Water Commission has remained a holy cow. So we need to really look at it closely. So I believe it's not, you know, if you look at, there will be some differences about what India needs to do in terms of water sector reforms and changes. There will be some difference of opinion. But there is no denying that we need fundamental change. And if, instead of what, the question is how is it going to come about? If you look at the Water Resource Establishment Institute itself in India, and their track record, I don't see that anything coming out from them. So basically, either we need an external force. Lokpal is the recent example that comes to mind. You know, something a force, public force like that, which will put the institute on the better reform agenda. Or if the political will, some establishment comes in. But the only time in the last 65 years that we have seen a sort of a Nixon moment of India, incidentally Nixon is infamous for corruption, but it seems an era which has been credited with some of the most fundamental changes in US. It was that time when the US introduced the National Environment Protection Act, Federal Water Pollution Act, Clean Water Act, Clean Air Act, and Environment Protection Agency was set up. The only time when India we saw such a moment was possibly first 2 years of Rajiv Gandhi's era, where with the first time national water policy came up, Sardar Sarovar clearance was actually stopped by Rajiv Gandhi era for 4 years. When he made the famous statement about big irrigation projects are not benefiting, he made a very big speech to the irrigation ministers, and he said those in so many words. He started the River Action Plan, I mean the precursor to it, the Ganga Action Plan. The Environment Protection Act came out in that time. The MOEF became a ministry at that time. And he put in place a very, very effective person who became famous later on for a different reason. But the person who was at the helm of the ministry did very good work. The person was of course Shashank. But unfortunately, by early 1987, Rajiv Gandhi was politically very weak, and he had to give in to a lot of pressures under him. One of the things he had to give in was clearance to Sardar Sarovar project. But that's a different story, I won't go into it. But it seems that after that, the status quo has prevailed, and such a moment seems unlikely in the near future. But there are a lot of successful innovations also coming from outside the establishment, and that's where I see there is a lot of hope, and a lot of us would like to see there is a hope. In terms of micro ideas with macro possibilities, well recharging and check dam movement, with Tushar mentioned in the morning in Gujarat, Arvari River Parliament and Tarun Bharat Singh work, Kali Ben River cleaning, the only river which has been really cleaned up, a very polluted river which has been cleaned up is because of some social efforts led by Abbasi Chewal group. Exemplary village watershed development programs, local water system, several examples across India. The traditional water harvesting system, local water harvesting system, rainwater harvesting. The dam wisdom from CSE comes to my mind. If they all came from outside, and then the government has been paying some lip service to it. Innovative grazing land management, Chopa system of Laporia. The system of rice intensification, which I learned first time at the annual partners meeting of IWMA, which has been a really great thing. And now it is spreading to wheat, sugarcane and other crops. The issue of environment flows, which again came out from the outside, this thing largely from outside India and the pressure from environmental groups. The India Water Portal and the Water Resource Information System, which have both have great potential, but I think there is yet to be really achieved. Right to Information Act also came out from came first from outside the establishment. The government had to adopt it. And I think these are big impacts on the way the water governance will happen in India, and it's already some changes are happening. The other bigger ideas, Narmada Andolan, I think I was part of it, not just because of that, I am saying it was the fountain year of education that had many ideas and repercussions. The World Commission on Dams actually happened as one of the implications of that, not just of NPA but other movements around the world, and how the World Bank was filling corner. Chipko, there was movement against destructive dams and hydro projects. This fire is actually spreading very fast. We are not recognizing it. But this is a big movement that is going on in India today. Unrecognized as because it's not happening in a coordinated way. But the biggest India anti-dam movement is now happening in Assam. I have never seen a rally of 5 lakh people against dams, but that's happening in Assam. That has happened. So, and it's become a political issue. For the first time in India, election issue, a dance, whether dance should be built or not. Last elections, every political party in Assam had to take a stand. The Ganga movement, to protect the river, which is again something new coming out from the outside the establishment. The issue of cumulative impacts, you know, our establishment is happy to look at the project specific way. But it has a cumulative impact at river basin level in terms of carrying capacity, river basin assessments. Again, establishment is giving lip service, but not really seriously. The right to water for domestic needs and livelihoods and fundamental right also is also incidentally one of the things that was good about the first draft of the National Water Policy 2012 was that it actually used that words, the right to water has to be part of the fundamental rights. Unfortunately, it has been dropped in the later drafts. But because of the pressure of number of groups, the water policy has accepted a number of changes that some of us have been pushing for. Lot of this seems like good ideas, but has not really had a macro impact. These have not led to big ticket reforms, basically, because the government has not really agreed to adopt any of these innovations within the system. So where do we go from here? Well, how do we, the question is, as I said, it's not what, lot of these things are already available out there, what we need to do. The question is, how are you going to happen? How can you build these innovations from outside and inside into a larger policy level, macro level affair? How to upscale and mainstream? How can you achieve bottom-up governance that will also allow creating and growing space for such innovations? In that context, I should say that think tanks like IPP is really very good. But we need really lot of more think tanks who is ready to take no-nonsense stand, who is ready to take stand which is not very pleasant and convenient for establishment, and is ready to call a spade a spade. We don't have too many of them, and we need some of them which may also help. But more than anything else, I'm sure this audience has a very healthy skepticism for marches, occupations, urgent demand, public action. But I believe that's something that will be required if we really need water establishment is to change, or if a political will is to be created within the establishment to change. Anyway.